Oh, how the turntables. It was just yesterday. We were talking about how the SEC was suing everybody. They were going after influencers. They were going after businesses. They had already taken a big stance up against Impact Theory, who had made $30 million on an NFT, and they had to pay $6 million back. And of course, Richard Haar and the different things that were going on. And today, the exact opposite. Looks like they just won. Grayscale just won their case against the SEC. Now, this is the big hot topic. I know you've heard this a lot of different places, but here's my take. First of all, it's amazing what 24 hours can do. This was our video yesterday. I was pretty negative. Let's be honest. I was not too impressed with what was going on in the SEC. And then today, we get this. This is the United States Court of Appeals. Now, this is 21 pages long. I'm not going to go over the whole thing. I linked in the description. You can check it out. But we had a pretty good summary of that, and that was done by CoinDesk. And it is interesting to me that as these big cases come forward and we see Bitcoin and crypto and digital assets becoming more in the limelight, it seems like everybody is cheering for us, which is crazy to me, because in 2017, we were like the outcasts. We were like the people that didn't know what the heck was going on, and we had no idea how to invest. And now all of a sudden we get like CNBC and MSNBC and even Fox News, and they talk about crypto like, and Bitcoin specifically, like it's the next greatest thing. So to me, it just feels kind of weird, you know, when you have these big things come up and you have a big news alert and they're talking about how the SEC just lost. I mean, I'll take it. It's a good day, but it's just it's a very different way to look at things. And maybe this is what we're looking for mass adoption. So here's why you came here. The SEC just lost another case, which is very odd because they've had a pretty good track record. I mean, they did lose against Mark Cuban in the insider trading case, and he really beat him like a drum. But we see now that they lost against Ripple. Now they're going to appeal that. But here was a bigger case, and they lost this one too. And this is what it means, because when I read this, remember, this doesn't mean that there's an automatic approval coming for a spot ETF. There's a couple more steps. Here's what we got. So the SEC must review Grayscale's Bitcoin ETF bid after a previous rejection. This is the appeals court. And this is what was said by the judge. The SEC recently approved the trading of two Bitcoin futures funds on national exchanges, but denied approval of Grayscale's Bitcoin fund. Petitioning for review of the commission's denial order, Grayscale maintains its proposed Bitcoin ETP or exchange traded product is materially similar to the Bitcoin futures exchange traded product and should have been approved to trade on the New York Stock Exchange. Let me read that one more time. Just this last part. It was similar to the Bitcoin futures exchange traded products or ETP and should have been approved. The SEC didn't explain why it was treating these products differently, making the Grayscale denial arbitrary and capricious. Capricious. Excuse me. Not a word I use all the time. Grayscale has demonstrated its proposed Bitcoin ETP is materially similar across relevant regulatory factors to the approval Bitcoin futures ETPs. First, the underlying assets, Bitcoin and Bitcoin futures, are closely correlated. And second, their surveillance sharing agreements with the CME are identical and should have the same likelihood of detecting fraudulent or manipulative conduct in the market for Bitcoin and Bitcoin futures. So the whole thing comes down to this. The judge is pretty much saying, and this is what we talked about on the channel for quite some time, is if you're going to approve a futures ETF, there's no reason why you can't approve a spot ETF. Now you can go back and say, look, there's not enough monitoring. That's the whole reason why Grayscale and all the different rest of them, ARK, Fidelity, went back and said, okay, we'll have some type of surveillance. Coinbase will do these things and we'll move forward. Good. But it seems like it wasn't enough. So now here we are. And the appeals court is saying you shouldn't have denied it. So you're going to have to go back and it's going to have to review it. So what does that mean? Well, for markets in general, it means everything's dandy today. And let's take the win, right? Let's take the win. Let's bask in the glory of beating the SEC yet again. So Bitcoin 24 hours is up 6.5%, 5%. You all know this because you've been checking your portfolio like 30 times this morning. And it's looking pretty good. To me, it is fascinating though that in 24 hours, I mean, Bitcoin up pretty high, 6.4. Polygon went up 6.4. Toncoin went up 6.3. Litecoin went up 6.4. Wrap Bitcoin out of that. Bitcoin Cash, for some reason, went up 15%. Just kidding. If you like Bitcoin Cash, have at it. I don't care. ETH Classic. I mean, there's just some alts that are doing pretty darn good. And that's great. So what does that mean moving forward? Does that mean that we're going to get this ETF and everything's sunny and shiny and rainbows? Maybe. This is Jake Trubinsky. He's the chief legal policy officer and lawyer at Blockchain Association. This is what he states, and I have to agree with him. He says, look, it's very rare for a federal circuit court to find an agency that has violated the APA by acting arbitrarily, again, and capriciously. Capriciously. Damn that word. The DC District Court, or circuit, just delivered a huge embarrassment for the SEC, but the ETF isn't approved yet. The APA, as I understand it, is how the government agencies are regulated and how they are supposed to set up and rule against things like this. And the SEC is pretty much going against that. They violated the APA by acting arbitrarily. And Jake says, well, what could happen here? The court didn't order the SEC to approve Grayscale's approval. It just said the SEC's analysis was on the fraud and manipulation was wrong. Now the SEC has to go back and review the proposal again. So what's the SEC going to do? There's two theories. It's very simple. He said, look, it's either they're going to go back and they're going to say, fraud manipulation, it's still there, and here's the reason why, and we're going to deny these things. That's one. But that'd be very irresponsible, I think, for them. Because if you think about it, they actually have an out right now. Gary Gensler, I think, misread a lot of the public sentiment, especially after the FTX, the Voyager, the Celsius, and the BlockFi. And of course, he missed all those, let's be honest. So he was trying to overprotect. Maybe he just misread things, and maybe this is the perfect opportunity for him to say, you know what? All right, the public has spoken, the courts have spoken, and we're going to go the opposite way. We're going to approve this. That is what could potentially happen. And it would be like a perfect out, right? It'd be the perfect out for him to do it and just go, look, you know, we did our best and, you know, we're here for regulation and this is what it says. So we're going to go forward with it. We're just going to obey by the court law, the rule of law, and we're going to move forward. Great. Could still be done. Will the ETF be approved? I don't know. I still have my wary thoughts, but it's going to make it a lot bit more difficult for them to disapprove these spot ETFs. However, it really comes out of this. Who does Gary work for? Now, in the comment section, I can see it right now. People are saying Gary works for BlackRock, Rob. That's who Gary works for. And I say maybe. I still say that Gary works for the White House. And he works for the president that is sitting there right now. I don't think he's going to be still sitting there in 2025, but whatever. He still sits there. He's still under that umbrella. And I do not believe that the White House wants anything to do with Bitcoin and their ESG compliant nonsense and all the things. So could it be approved? It's looking more positive, but is it a lock? I don't think so. And it's really gonna come out of this. The ETFs right now, these are all the ones that have been filed. ARK iShares, which is BlackRock, Bitwise, Van Acquisition Tree, you can read. And the deadline, I always found this funny that they have first deadlines and second deadlines and third deadlines and final deadlines. But just so you know, today is the 29th, I think. Yeah, August 29th. In 2 or 3 days, you're going to get the first deadline for iShares, for Bitwise, for VanEck, for WisdomTree, Wise, Valkyrie. All of them are coming 2, 3, 4 days is their first deadline. Now, ARK's already been pushed forward. They hit the first deadline, second deadline, third deadline, and they pretty much said, we're just looking for public opinion, which a lot of people come in and they say, yeah, it's good, but a lot more people say it's awful. That's, we covered this before. So we'll see if they come through and they say, no, we're not going to approve it. I don't think they're going to approve it on the first deadline. They're pretty much going to push it. They're going to kick the can on the road. I don't see it happen until 2024, but I could be wrong. And again, remember, I think there was a couple of articles that just came out that said all these decisions are going to be pushed until 2024. Anyhow, let me know what you think about that in the comments section. And good news for friend of the show, Simon Dixon. I actually stole the article from him as he tweeted out. And I said, hey, Simon, looks like I'm going to have to wear that stupid shirt because I might lose the bet. If you don't know, the bet is I believe that I do not believe the ETF will be approved. I said this a long time ago. And Simon Dixon said, I believe it is. And I said, okay, let's do a bet. Whoever loses that bet has to wear a t-shirt that says, I love Mashinsky. Now, there's nothing more, well, there's a lot, there's more things that I actually dislike than Alex Mashinsky, but he's on the top 10. And if I got to wear that stupid shirt, I'm not going to be too happy. But I will say this, I will gladly wear it because all of our portfolios will be doing pretty damn good. So that's it. Simon, here's to you, hoping that you win. And then to finish up on a couple of notes, it is amazing what 24 hours will do, sentiment and all those things. We can't get ahead of ourselves, but we should be happy for these days, right? And just like yesterday, we talked about this video that we went through and we took a look at the NFT space. The SEC sued Impact Theory, which I got to tell you, they made $30 million on NFT and they only had to pay $6.1 million back. That's like JP Morgan style right there. To me, that's like the cost of doing business. They also have an interview with Richard Hart. And then the whole thing about this was the NFTs. They said it was NFTs are now securities. That's what they were claiming. And because Impact Theory was like, look, we got $30 million. We'll pay you six. Just go away. We'll keep the rest. But at some point, we're going to have to fight against the SEC and NFTs. And I thought that was going to be a big blow, especially to Web3 gaming. It was not too positive. But I mean, I saw a way out. And in that video, I talked about this very clearly. I said, look, I don't know what the market's going to do. And every time I think I know what the market's going to do, the market does the exact opposite. And this Grayscale decision, I knew it was a decision coming. I thought it was going to come soon. I didn't think they would win outright. So much the better. So during this time, what I'm always talking about, I don't know what the market's going to do, but I still dollar cost average. It's the same thing every day. It's like Groundhog's Day. I have Coinbase. I've connected my bank. I sign up for Coinbase One. It's like 19 bucks a month or something like that because I pay for the full year. I don't pay for any fees up to $10,000. I don't have a link for them. I'm sure you can find Coinbase. Good luck. And it all just comes out automatically. It's always the same thing. It's always Bitcoin, Ethereum, Cardano, Solana, Chainlink, Arbitrum, Near, a bunch of other stuff that I buy every single day. Because right now is when I think is the time to buy. I'm not telling you to do something because I can't give you financial advice. I'm not your dad. I'm not even a financial advisor. Just a guy that talks to his computer in a nice green screen. So the thing you have to remember is this. Even though we think we know where things are going, we'll never know. No one's got a crystal ball. And this was actually from the comments section yesterday. And I want to read this out to you. I Jimenez. And he said, look, my opinion is this. I've already given up on crypto. I've already lost too much money. I don't see any future in crypto. I don't see any adoption. I don't buy into the shilling of crypto anymore. Stuck with a bunch of rug pulls at this moment, 90% declines. I don't see why anyone would want to get into crypto at this time or ever again. This is the capitulation. And I pretty much said, I'm like, I don't blame you. I can see why. It's tough. It's not for everybody. And I understand if you have to get out of here. And that's true. But isn't it amazing what 24 hours can do? Now we're up so much. Now we have positive sentiment. Now we're looking forward. And also, there was a tweet I could not find. But if you go into look into Bitcoin, let's just do that. If you go to look into Bitcoin, it's a free website, 100% free. It's got really great charts. And if you take a look at the hash rate, the tweet I'm talking about, it took a look at the four-year cycles, and it just said that this time in the last cycle, in 2019, we were actually declining in hash rate. And before that, it was 2015. I mean, as we took a look at the four-year cycles, right? Everything starts with the halving, then an all-time high, then a huge dip and a reset. Then there's a halving, 2016, 2017 all-time high, 2018 is a huge dip, 2019 is a reset, so on and so forth. But they said what's interesting about this time frame is that we've actually reached all-time highs for hash rates. And in the last times, in 2015 and 2019, we were way below. So I think maybe there's a little bit of hope on the horizon, but I'm not going to start dumping all my money into Bitcoin. I will still continue dollar cost average because, again, you never know. And then even if you're the smart money, you're the big investors, you still mess it up. This is from CryptoSlate, digital asset investment products see a massive 168 million in outflows. Here's what's happening. This was just last week. Digital asset investment products recorded significant outflows totaling $168 million last week, marking its largest outflow since March. For the report, Bitcoin and Ethereum was responsible for most of the outflows. The flagship digital asset saw roughly $166 million in total out. So again, it's tough to time the market. I'm not good at it. I'm just here for the long haul. And I'll dollar cost average because it's a strategy that I came up with. Well, I didn't come up with it, but it's what I decided to move forward as I looked at everything that I could possibly do. And it was at the most sane moment that I could get after we saw the all-time highs and the all-time lows. And I said, you know what? This is where I'm going to move forward. So I'm not going to change. And that's just how it is. Any elements you might think about that in the comments. And then I have to do a PSA for everybody. Public service announcement, which is this. There was this great thread from Tay. And I got to need to put this in so you guys can all read it. It's very long. But people are losing their crypto. Tay, save. And they're losing their crypto off of hot wallets like MetaMask. They're losing them on their cold storage devices like a Nano Ledger. And there's like these random occurrences of where people are losing their crypto, and it's a lot. And it's happening over months and months and months. And Tay says, for the past 40 hours, I've been unwinding a massive wallet draining operation. I don't know how big it has been, but since December 20, 2022, it's drained 5,000 plus ETH and a massive amount of tokens. It's wrecked my friends and OGs who are reasonably secure. And you can read this. It's a lot of stuff. And a lot of people have been complaining that they just, their funds and their cold storage devices, their hot wallets, they're all, not all gone, but people are just losing things. And that's very concerning. But if you get to it, to like the tweet that's like, there's a lot of tweets, so I'll save you from this. You can read the whole thing. But really what it came down to is this. 99% or the majority, the large, vast majority of people who are losing this crypto are people who had taken their seed phrases and they had put them in LastPass. And you don't know what LastPass is. It's on a browser and you can put all your passwords. And what they were doing is instead of taking their Nano Ledger mnemonic phrase and writing it down someplace secure, they would put it in LastPass, which is essentially just uploading your phrases so that all the different scammers and hackers that are out there can find it. And they can find it. So if you've done that, it's okay. But you need to rectify that quickly. What you need to do, first of all, is you need to take all that crypto that you have, if you put in LastPass or someplace that you stored online in the cloud or something, you need to take all that crypto, move it all. To be safe, you can just buy another Nano Ledger or another Tangent wallet, one of my two favorite picks right now. Tangent, pretty good. And you can do one of two things. You can wait for it to arrive, you can erase everything, or you can put it all the way back on an exchange for quick storage, get your device, and then bring it all back. Whichever way you want to do it. Again, I'm not your daddy, figure it out. So that's the PSA for today. People are losing their funds because maybe I didn't tell you guys not to do this, but don't upload your mnemonic phrases to any place where that's connected to the internet. Paper works good. Paper looks great, or put it on steel. Yeah. So that's it, everybody. So I just wanted to do a quick one. Hey, not bad. So that's it for this episode for the news. Usually I don't do live streams during the week, but we've had two big news days. So I wanted to go live just to get the stuff out there. Thanks so much for stopping by. I appreciate it. See you guys in the next one. Hit the like on your way out. Thanks so much.